Good morning. Please be attentive to the following announcements, also on Antioch's website. Registration for in-person worship begins each Monday morning at 8 a.m. and ends Thursday at 1 p.m. on Antioch's website, in the weekly reminders, on Facebook, and Antioch Missionary Baptist Church Charlotte on Eventbrite.com. Only those who do not have internet access may call the church at 704-332-4951 Tuesdays from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. or Wednesdays and Thursdays from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. You must register each week you wish to attend. Antioch continues to follow its COVID-19 safety protocols, including mask wearing, during all on-site and in-person worship services, programs, events, and activities until June. We encourage those who have not done so to get vaccinated and a booster shot if you are eligible. Save the date! Saturday, May 14th, for the outdoor dedication and community welcoming celebration of our new community walking trail. The gathering will begin at 10 a.m. and the program will start at 10:30 a.m. There will be food trucks, music, and games from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Come see, come walk, come enjoy. Get ready for our Women's Day Mother's Day celebration next Sunday, May 8th at 10 a.m. with a women's devotional from 9:30 to 9:45 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Our theme is Created to be Uniquely Me from Psalms 139 verses 13 and 14. Guest preacher will be Dr. Monica Redman of St. Paul Baptist Church. Come dressed in your spring colors and help us celebrate and honor mothers and all women. LOL Adult Bible Study will resume this Wednesday, May 4th at 6:30 p.m. The topic of study is called Fractured Faith. If you have ever grappled with disillusionment, suffering, church hurt, doubt, and disappointment in the Christian life, this Bible study is for you. Don't miss it. Seniors on the Move Ministry is refiring up the ministry. Join them in the Fellowship Hall every Tuesday and Thursday at 10 a.m. beginning May 3rd for ministry, fellowship, and fun. Get out to rep, registrate, educate, participate, then vote. Early voting has started and ends May 14th. Persons may register to vote during early voting with your ID and proof of residence. Primary election day is Tuesday, May 17th. Vote for the candidates of your choice. Your vote is a terrible thing to waste. For the months of May and June, Pastor will be preaching a new sermon series titled, Easter is Not Over. On the Christian calendar, what's next are two more very exciting times that followed Easter, Ascension Day and Pentecost Sunday. These sermons will be about the wonderful occurrences that took place around these two important days. Hear how things really got heated up. And the disciples got fired up when Jesus ascended and the Holy Spirit descended, as recorded in the book of Acts. For more details and sign-up information, visit the announcements page on Antioch's website, www.antiochfamily.org. Download our church app. Check us out on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. My name is Donnie Garris, the pastor of the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church. It is good to be here on this May 1st Sunday morning. Amen. It's good to be here. I was on a prayer call earlier this morning, and Brother John Greer, those of us who are members of Antioch know Brother John Greer. He was on the prayer call this morning, and he said, "You know, Reverend, I want to thank the Lord for May the 1st. I've always enjoyed May the 1st. I've always celebrated May the 1st a special way." He said, "Pastor, do you remember we used to have May Day?" You remember May Day in school? You had that pole somewhere out in the field, and you had the kids run around the pole with these ribbons and wrap the pole, just rejoicing and enjoying the warmth of the day and the beauty of the day. Brother John Griss said, May Day always remind me when we would just come together and just enjoy one another. He said, Pastor, I always enjoy May 1st because that reminds me of May Day. I said, Brother John Griss, I'm going to use that for an opening this morning. I enjoy coming together with the house of the Lord. It is a beautiful day. I don't know about you, but I am glad to be living on this day. I'm glad to be with you. And anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord on this day? Chat. And if you are a special guest of ours, in other words, a first or second time guest of our experience here, please put in the chat new. We just want to know that you are with us for the first or second time, that someone from our AE team, our Antioch Engagers, will call you and let you know we welcome you and thank you for joining us this morning. Well, we're going to go ahead and get started. We have the combined choir, members who are part of our combined choir. We're going to bless us with a song. Let us rejoice. Rejoice in the strength that the Lord has given us. Rejoice in the energy that the Lord has provided us. Let's put those hands together. Let's step out. Let's just we
Okay, y'all know I don't get out much, but that was good. Good morning, church. Our scripture reading this morning is going to be coming from Acts 1, 1 through 3 in the NIV. In my former book, Theopolis, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit and the apostles he had chosen. Father God, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us Christ to be my Savior, and thank you for your mighty plans and purposes, which you are in the process of bringing to completion. Help me to live by faith and not by sight, for I believe that all you have purposed and planned will come to fruition in your time, in your way, and to you, I praise you. Your glory and honor, amen. I want to remind people out there and in the church that this is First Sunday, May Day, like Pastor said. Pastor, I don't remember May Day being that fun for me because I'm short. And you know that pole that everybody was running around hitting the ball? At a certain point, I couldn't reach it. So May Day wasn't that fun for me. But I do enjoy May Day. But by saying that, this is First Sunday and this is Communion Sunday. So I want to remind everybody out there in the internet world that you can go ahead, before we get to it, and get your, whatever you're going to use, your juice, your crackers, or a piece of bread ready for when we get ready to do communion. It's giving time. Yeah. Now, most of the time when we say it's giving time, most of our minds go to money. However you give it, your weekly money, your monthly money. But let's just set the scene. You attend church, you read your Bible, you attend Bible study, Sunday school, and try your best to follow Jesus. You even tithe regularly. But money has been tight. You may be throwing every dime you earn at that debt, or you're in the middle of a difficult work season, or you may be seasonable, and you just don't have that extra cash flow. So you start to wonder to yourself, if tithing, giving 10% of your monthly income to your local church is necessary. Now, before the finance team looks at me like I'm cuckoo for Cocoa Puffs and raises their eyebrow at me for telling you this, the money we give is important. It helps us pay the bills and keep the doors open here at church, and is very appreciated. Maybe you don't have a lot of money, but you have time. Would it be okay to replace tithes with service to your church instead? That's a great question, but actually it's the wrong question to be asking. The right question is, can you give your time in addition to your tithes? And yes, and you should. Giving your time is a great way to honor God and to show love to others, but you can't give your time instead of your tithes. And probably wondering, Minister Brown, why are you going here? It's because, you know, a lot of people kind of wonder about this. When I was talking to my son about it, he was like, Mom, so that's what it's all about. So I'm telling you, that's what it's all about. You see, the Bible offers no alternatives to giving a tithe, so that our time isn't a good substitute. What the Bible does encourage us to do is both service and tithes, especially if you don't have the cash to give above the tithes that you usually give or you're supposed to give. Tithing is really a baseline for giving. The Bible actually encourages us to give generously far beyond the tithe, but it's not impossible for a lot of people when they're digging out of debt or going through a financial rough season, or maybe don't feel like it's their obligation to give back to God. In this case, and really in any case, giving your time is an excellent way to give a little extra. At the end of the day, through serving doesn't replace the tithe. Tithing is a form of worship because it shows you trust Him, not money to provide. Matthew 6:24 reminds us that we cannot worship God and money at the same time. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You can't serve God and money. On the other hand, when you serve, you worship God by stewarding your time and your talents for Him. And Matthew 25:40 tells us that whatever we do to serve others in need, we do for Him. Y'all see where I'm going with this? Serving Him is an awesome form of generosity. So yes, He wants you to serve and give your time, but He also wants you to put your faith and love in Him instead of money, especially since He blesses and provides us 100%, and He's only asking for 10% of it back. Now, tithing isn't a salvation issue, and God isn't going to condemn you if you don't do it, but tithing is for your benefit. God doesn't need your money. He wants your heart. Tithing is a way to give your heart to God because because you're reminding yourself that your security lies in Christ alone. When you stop tithing, you stand on the truth. So, what do you do if your money is tight and you're tempted to stop tithing? Look for different ways to increase your income. Decrease your expenses, like Starbucks, going out to eat lunch every day, and any luxury that's not necessary, like getting a car washed at Auto Bell. Okay. When managing your money, always give first, save second, and spend third. Giving your money will help you learn to trust that living this life God's way with only 90% of your money is greater than living your way with 100% of your money. His way is better, and Luke 16:10 tells us that He honors that choice. Whoever can be trusted with little, very little, can be trusted with a lot. And it's not just, you know, going to Bible study, that's a way of serving. Going to Sunday school, that's a way of serving. I had to throw that in there. God wants us to experience that firsthand, giving Him the opportunity to show up in our lives when we honor Him. And that not only that, He wants our relationship with Him to grow, that we, with however possible. All of that can happen through obedience, faithfulness to God by tithing. Here at the A, we have five convenient ways to support Antioch other than service. There is the online church app, online at Antioch's website, www.antiochfamily.org, or you can mail it to the church at 232 Skyland Avenue, or you can text to give. Go to your text messaging feature on your phone. As you would send a text to a recipient, type in the bar 73256. As you would send a message, type in AMBC 232 and your giving amount. Place it in a basket on your, okay, so if you have an envelope, and you know, you would place it in a basket on your way out of church, but everybody hold up your envelope and however you're going to give your tithes. Let us pray. Father God, it's in the name of Jesus that we come. We know that tithing and money is a hard thing to talk about in church, anyplace else. But as I said, God wants us to honor him with our giving. God wants us to be obedient with our giving. As we go and start thinking about tithing, if we're not able to do, you know, think about some of the things that we mentioned, God will bless that as well. Father God, as we continue to go through our church service, let us all be mindful of you and the reason why we're here. It's in your Son Jesus' name I pray and ask it all. Amen.
We thank Minister Brown for sharing with us, encouraging us to see the importance of what we call total stewardship. Total stewardship is not only your tithes, but it also includes time and talent. God wants it all, and all to him we do owe. And so we pray that you will continue to bless us with total stewardship, and we thank you and are very appreciative for what you give of not only your time and your talents, but also your time. Let me sneak this in. I don't normally do this now that we've been doing worship a new way, and that is try to go back and enhance or expound upon some of the announcements that have already been given. You all remember before the pandemic, I used to come back and spend another 30 minutes talking about what you've already heard and seen and read. But I want to sneak this in because I do recognize that we have a wider audience that is with us as well. And this applies to all, and that is, it's time to vote, y'all. Early voting has started here, and it will continue until May 14th. And then on May 17th will be the primary election. Election, if we have not learned by now, if we have not learned it by now, it is important. It is important that we vote. It is important, or else you will get somebody into office that will jack you up. And so we need to make sure we are doing our part to put in people we feel as though have the heart of God, that is compassion for people and willing to do good for all. And so it is election time. Just want to encourage you to get out and do early voting, which you are not restricted to your precinct. Do it now. You don't have to worry about taking off work on the 17th to get your vote in. But we do want to encourage you to vote. And then secondly, those of you who have been coming to the church, you've noticed that there is a walking trail around the church. Amen. There's a walking trail that has asphalt, and we wanted to provide. We've been given some grants by the county and Village Heartbeat, Inc., to put a walking trail in the community, for the community, and it is here at Antioch. And so what we want to do is on May 14th, have a big celebration outdoors. I mean, we got something planned big, y'all. Just come, invite family and friends, and we want to invite the community, because we call it a community track for a reason. It is for the community. And so not only for May 14th, we're gonna have food trucks, we're gonna have bouncies, and we're gonna have games, and we're gonna have some DJs out here spinning it. And I told them, keep it right now. We don't wanna be out here with some folks, you know, dropping it like it's hot. We might do some line dancing, but we're just gonna have fun. Invite the community to celebrate what has been provided for them. Now, what I do need is some people to meet me out here on Saturday, May the 7th, the Saturday before Mother's Day. If you can just give me an hour, I think we can knock this out in an hour. And that is, I wanna go door to door in this vicinity, sharing some leaflets that will let them know, come,
Come to the celebration. It is for you. It is for you, and we welcome you. So I'm going to need some people to help me to put on their sneakers, and let's go door to door and leave some leaflets and let them know they are welcome to come. And this is for the community. Amen. Amen. Just meet me out here on Saturday at 10 a.m. I believe we can knock this out in an hour and complete what we need to do to get ready for May 14th. Thank you for letting me sneak that in. Well, I said it's not over, y'all. Easter is not over. The Easter season is not over. Easter is not supposed to be like the 4th of July. And that is the 4th of July. You have all the fireworks, right? And then the next day you just go around and pick up the pieces and go on about your day. Easter is not like 4th of July. Easter is not over, y'all. What I mean by that, there is such a thing as the Christian calendar that tried to capture the major and significant events in the life of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And on the Christian calendar, you have what is next. And there are two more exciting events that follow Easter. Ascension Day, which is observed the 40th day after Easter. And based on our present day calendar, that will be Thursday, May the 26th. And then there is Pentecost Sunday, which is observed the 50th day after Easter. And based on our current calendar, that will be Sunday, June the 5th. Some things happen. Things just start to get heated up, y'all. And the disciples got fired up around these two events. So today what I want to do is talk about something that took place around the time of the first of the two exciting events that took place after Easter. And that is Jesus' ascension. That's what the text is dealing with today, Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. And I look forward to coming back for you and sharing with you the things that just took place around Jesus' ascension. All right, the choir is going to come. Let's rejoice and praise the Lord one more time. Amen.
Thank you.
until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. I want to talk about the things that took place around this next event that took place after Easter, the ascension. And I want to talk about Jesus appeared. Jesus appeared. According to a legend, when Jesus returned to heaven following his death on the cross and resurrection from the grave, legend goes that the angels in heaven gathered in amazement at Jesus' return. They gazed as he entered back into their presence. They gazed at his wounds in his hands, the wound on his side, and the wounds in his feet. They looked at his thorn-bruised head, and the angels shuddered as they recalled his vicarious and vicious suffering on the cross. Legend goes that Gabriel finally spoke up. And he said to Jesus, "Master, for God so loved that mean old world, that mean old world that you suffered so terribly down there for, God so loved that old mean world for all the sins of all the people in the world, does the world know? Does the world appreciate the extremity and the enormity and the extent of your sacrifice for that mean old world?" Jesus said, "No, not yet. Right now, only a handful of people in Palestine know what I did for that mean old world." Gabriel asked, "Then what have you done to let everyone else in the world know what you did for them?" Jesus said, "Well, I've asked Peter, I've asked Thomas, James, John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, I've asked Mary and Salome and some other women and a few other folks to go out and spread the news about what I've done for this mean old world. And I'm trusting that they would tell others, who would then 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 tell others, on and on until the message spreads to the ends of the world." Gabriel shook his head. He said, "You know, I know about those fickle folks in that old world. I know how fearful and forgetful they can get. I know about their fallen nature. You got to have a backup plan. You have to have a plan B." To which Jesus said, "I have no plan B. There is no alternative strategy. I've commanded, I've commissioned these few to go into the world. And I'm counting on them, and I'm counting on others to help get the news out to the rest of the world. There is no other plan. I'm depending on them." The moral of the story is, 21 centuries later, Jesus still has no other plan. He's counting on you. He's counting on me. Go into the world and be a witness to all that he has said, to all that he has done. The mode of communication, the method of communicating this good news has changed. But the message of the good news has not changed. Jesus born, Jesus died, Jesus rose. Jesus lives, Jesus ascended, and Jesus is coming again. Look at this text. It's a very interesting text here. Luke is the writer. Luke is the writer of both the gospel that bears his name and the book of Acts. Gospel of Luke, Acts of the Apostles are two volumes of a single work by the penmanship of Luke. Luke wrote the book of Acts to be the part two, if you will, the continuation of what he had written in his gospel. Sort of like, anybody like watching the show This Is Us? I love that show, This Is Us. This Is Us have had so many episodes, new seasons, more series, and they're coming to what is called their season finale. But their season finale is really not the end. It's just a break. They're just taking a hiatus, if you will. A season finale is often the final episode to be produced for a few months. It may contain a cliffhanger ending so that viewers will continue watching what the season and series will bring again in the next time. In other words, it's really not over. It's just an episode. Luke says what I wrote in the gospel was the season finale, but it's not the end of the story. There's another season coming. Oh my God, help me. There's another series coming. There's more. There's a new season that is coming. So he wrote the gospel, and he also wrote Acts as part two. According to Esau Macaulay, in his book, Reading While Black, he said Luke wrote these two volumes, Luke and Acts, for this purpose. He said Luke's whole goal is writing Luke Acts. That's why they're called Luke Acts. He wrote Luke Acts. The whole goal was to show that God's plan was always for the nations. It's God's plan for the nations to know, to worship, and to obey the Messiah. Luke is writing as a Gentile to other Gentiles to tell them that they have a place in God's kingdom. They have a place in the kingdom of God as sons and daughters. This place as sons and daughters in God's kingdom trumps any attempt by lesser kingdoms to make them second-class citizens. In other words, Luke's whole goal in writing Luke's Acts is to inform everybody that we are all God's children. In the Gospel of Luke, Luke showed that Jesus loved all kinds of people. Jesus came, says Luke, to be good news for all people, especially the poor, especially the prisoners, especially the blind, the oppressed, the sick, the diseased, the diseased, the handicapped, the bereaved, the bereft, the outcast, the ostracized, the stigmatized, the sinful folks, the crazy folks, the Gentiles, the Samaritans, the betraying Judases, the denying Peters, the prodigals, the childless, the widows. One commentator said Luke often wrote about and identified by name the women Christ met and spoke to. He also gave more attention to children than any other gospel writer, because Jesus is portrayed as an actual person in history who came to seek and to save anybody, everybody who is lost. Luke wanted to tell others that Christ's coming brought hope and salvation to everybody.
Now you see the connection to Acts. In Acts, Luke shows Jesus wants his disciples to go be witnesses of this good news that he wrote about in Luke. Be witness of this good news of God's kingdom plan, God's kingdom hope and salvation to all people in the world. The book of Acts, Luke tells how the disciples of Jesus are endowed and empowered, anointed and appointed by the Holy Spirit, and they were to organize as a body of believers to continue God's kingdom plan of including all God's children, be missionaries, witnesses in Jerusalem, all over Judea, in Samaria, go all over the world, spreading the good news across all geographies and all generations, that Jesus loved everybody. And he came to seek and save everybody. Both at the start of the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostle, Luke states his motivation for writing to a person whose name is Theophilus. Look at what he says if you have your Bibles in Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. Luke chapter 1, verses 1 through 4, the New Living Translation. He says, many people have set out to write accounts about the events that have been fulfilled among us. They used eyewitness reports circulating among us from the early disciples. Having carefully investigated everything from the beginning, I also have decided to write an accurate account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so you can be certain of the truth of everything you were taught. Acts chapter 1, verse 1 through 2, he says, in my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instruction through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. Don't you see it? Both the gospel and Acts were written to a person by the name of Theophilus. Now we do know that Theophilus is a real person that he's referring to. But we don't know exactly who Theophilus is. The only two things we know about Theophilus is his name means dear friend who loves God, and hopefully he lived up to his name. And we know that Luke's remarks of him in the gospel, chapter 1, verses 1 through 3, he says, most excellent Theophilus, which scholars say suggests that Theophilus may have been an important Roman official, or at least a person of high position and great wealth. Theophilus is important to Luke, so important that he writes both the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of Apostles to him. He is the recipient of both Luke and Acts. Luke states he is writing to Theophilus to make certain that what he has been taught by Luke and the other evangelists about Jesus, that what he's been taught is true and trustworthy. In the Gospel, Luke says he wants Theophilus to be certain. Message version of the Bible says, to know beyond the shadow of a doubt the reliability of what you were taught. I want you to be certain of the truth about what Jesus did and what Jesus taught. Luke wants Theophilus to have certainty. He wants him to have accuracy about Jesus' life, Jesus' teachings, while Jesus was yet on earth. Luke wants Theophilus to know that what he writes about Jesus in his gospel account is the truth and nothing but the truth. About all the powerful words and works and messages and miracles Jesus did before Jesus was taken up to heaven. Luke says, at the start of Acts, I wrote, referring to the first volume, the gospel,
There I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. Notice that Luke implies that what Jesus did and taught in his gospel account in Luke was just the beginning of his work. Luke says, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do in my gospel writing, what he began to teach in my gospel writing. In other words, before Jesus ascended, before the day he was taken up to heaven, Jesus began and started something. He started doing wondrous works, and he started teaching mighty messages with the expectation of what he started would be continued. During Jesus' ministry on earth and up until the day he ascended, what we call the threefold work or threefold ministry of Jesus, preaching, teaching, healing / helping folks, was done primarily by him. That's what Luke recorded in his gospel. All that Jesus preached and all that he taught, all the healing and the helping he did in his gospel account was done primarily by Jesus. Now, when he comes to the book of Acts, who does he want to take up the work? Is there a backup plan? Is there a plan B to all that Jesus started to do? The healing, the preaching, and the healing, the teaching, the preaching, and the helping that he did in the gospel accounts. Is there another alternative? Who will be commanded and commissioned to now take up the work and continue it into all the world? Jesus is counting on somebody. He's counting on somebody in Acts to continue preaching, to continue teaching, to continue healing, to continue helping all manner of people in the world. He's dependent on somebody and the generation of those who follow them to continue to do the work that he began to do. It's in this writing of the book of Acts that Luke sets out to write what Jesus wanted to be continued after Jesus' ascension, during the absence of his physical presence. The Gospel of Luke chronicles what Jesus began to do in his public and personal ministry on earth. In the book of Acts, Luke captures before Jesus ascends back to heaven what Jesus wants his disciples to continue to do through the power and anointing of his Holy Spirit. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do, to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven. After giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. Before leaving planet Earth for heaven, Luke records in Acts that Jesus took time to get the ones he had chosen, his disciples, his apostles, those whom he had chosen. He had a little conversation with them before he got ready to go. He got them ready for the mission to take place next after his ascension. There were final things Jesus needed them to know and be sure of before he ascends and he's taken up to heaven. Notice what the record said. It said, after his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days. I told you the Easter season wasn't over. He hung around for 40 days. When it says after his suffering, it references the death on the cross, after he died on the cross and he was resurrected. When it says that Jesus presented himself and appeared, it means that he manifested, he revealed, he unveiled himself to them. Jesus showed up in various places and showed himself to various people and caused them to see him. The point about these presentations and appearances is that they would not have had any other way of seizing Jesus if he didn't show up. If he didn't show up and unveil himself in his resurrected glory, if he did not give himself to be seen, then they would not have known. One commentator said, that is not a And on the first night of his stay, she cooked a fine dinner, fried chicken, collard greens, pinto beans, candy yam, red Kool-Aid. Set the table, said, "Grandson, will you do the honor? Will you offer grace to God?" Grandson looked at grandma and said, "No. Grandma, I don't believe in God anymore. I don't believe in anything that science doesn't prove exists. Grandma, I've taken some college courses, and I've been taught that if you can't see it, you can't touch it, if you can't taste it, if you can't smell it, then it's not real. So, Grandma, if I can't see God, if I can't touch God, if I can't taste God, if I can't smell God, how then can I believe that God exists?" Grandma did all she could to explain why she believed in God and why she believed in his existence. She spent so many minutes, she exhausted her Bible verses, all the Bible verses she knew about God's existence. She exhausted everything she learned in Sunday school from every angle possible to get her son to change his mind that God does exist. But it was to no avail. He maintained he no longer believed in God and didn't believe anymore that God exists. Grandma sat quietly throughout the remainder of the dinner. What the grandson said troubled her to her heart, and she prayed before going to bed that evening, "God, help my grandson. Help me help my grandson to believe again." Well, she hadn't too long laid her head on the pillow when that evening, close to midnight, Grandma heard a holler come from the room of her grandson. Grandma jumped up, put on her bedroom slippers, threw on her raggedy wig, put on her raggedy house coat, shuffled her way down to grandson's room. When she opened the door, her grandson was sitting on the edge of the bed, holding his jaw. He was in severe pain, and he was just hollering, "Oh! It hurts, Grandma, it hurts." She said, "What hurts?" He said, "My tooth. I got a toothache, and it hurts." Grandma said, how do you know it's a toothache? Can you see it? Can you taste it? Can you touch it? Can you smell it? Grandson said, no, Grandma, but I can feel it. And Grandma said, that's how I know God is real. Sometimes I can feel. And not only because I can feel them, just like you feel the pain and sense its effects upon your body in your mouth. And I'm over here, I don't feel nothing. But because you are hollering and telling me that you're in pain, I must believe what you say is true. Although I cannot feel your pain, I must take your word that your pain is real. So, grandson, in a way, it's the same about me saying to you, God is real. And I feel him every now and then. Although you do not see God, cannot touch him, cannot taste him, cannot smell him, take my word for it. When I holler, God is real. Do I have any hollerers in here who know God is real? Yes, he is. He lives. You ask me how I know he lives. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, regardless what others say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He walks with me. He talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. Take my word when I holler. He lives. Down in my heart. Hold on, hold on. Let me get to the good stuff now. He lives. Go tell him now. I'm giving you enough evidence. Sometimes I make you feel it. Sometimes you take it because you heard it. And you hear the witness of others what they felt. But go tell it. He appeared to them. He presented to them over a period of 40 days. Permit me just enough time to tell you who the them that is captured in this text. Who were the them who were privileged to have Jesus present himself and appear to after his resurrection to prove that he spent 40 days presented himself, showing himself to them. Who's the them? Who's the them? When you consider the Gospels, the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, let them chime in. John, too, got something to say, as well as Luke. There's several details in the demonstrative accounts of the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus. Another Gospel writer who agrees with Luke is Mark. Can I put a footnote here for you Bible study students? Luke uses Mark, really, as a basis for much of what he writes about. Because it's believed that Mark was the first of the gospel writers to write down about the life and teachings of Jesus. And the rest of them, Matthew, Luke, chimed in and wrote off of what Mark said. And just added their own emphasis. So Luke is one of the synoptic witnesses along with Mark and Matthew. in Mark chapter 16, verses 9 through 14, and Luke captures the same occurrences, but he uses them for a different emphasis. Mark and Luke records three cases involving 14 eyewitnesses to whom Jesus appeared after his resurrection. Each of his appearances were life changers. Each of his appearances were life transforming. Each of his appearances were restoring and reviving. When Jesus appeared, each of his appearances were eye-opening and soul-stirring. No one was ever the same after they were honored and privileged with Jesus' appearances. Help me out, Mark and Luke. Mark chapter 16, verse 9 says, when Jesus arose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, watch this, out of whom he had driven out seven demons. It is interesting that only Mark and Luke identify Mary Magdalene as the one whom Jesus had driven out seven demons. Matthew don't say nothing about it. John don't say nothing about it. Only Mark and Luke qualifies that she was the one that Jesus drove out seven demons. I believe on that morning after the resurrection, that when Jesus first appeared to Mary, out of whom he had driven out seven demons, Mary must have had her love rekindled when Jesus first appeared to her. I told you only Mark and only Luke in chapter 8, verse 2 refers to Mary Magdalene was the one Jesus had driven and delivered seven demons out of her. Before she met Jesus, Mary was said to have been terrorized or tormented and tortured, suffered extreme inner turmoil with seven demons or evil spirits. The number seven inferred the severity of her possession. She was fully under demonic control. Demons were ravaging her life. Demons were ravaging her mind, her spirit, her emotion. Demons were ravaging her physically. Demons were making her life a living hell. And perhaps she had so much hell inside of her that she was making everyone else she came in contact with their lives a living hell too. She was just filled up with hell. But Jesus, I don't know when, but the record says one day Jesus showed up, healed, freed, and delivered her. And can you imagine on that Easter morning when Jesus appeared to Mary, that early Sunday resurrection morning, and she saw Jesus, the one who set her free. Jesus, the one who delivered her of the demons. Jesus, who healed her of illness. Jesus, who set her free. When she saw Jesus, it must have rekindled her love for Jesus all over again. Can you imagine? When she saw Jesus alive, she must have fallen in love with Jesus all over again. Because this was the Jesus who loved the hell out of her. Literally, she saw Jesus. Mary's appreciation of what he had done for her. Oh, what joy. Loving came over her when she saw Jesus. I'm just simply letting you know that when Jesus appears, he will remind you of how much he's done for you. It will create a heart of love and praise and thanks and gratitude. I know when Jesus shows up in your life, because I know you will respond, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. When I was filled up with my demons, thank you, Lord. When I was in sin, thank you, Lord. When I needed to be delivered, thank you, Lord. You set me free. How many of us know, Lord, when the Lord appears, he'll rekindle your love for him all over again. Mark says later, Jesus appeared. Let me hurry on. He appeared in a different form, meaning a different appearance from that in which he appeared to Mary, to two of them, out walking by the countryside. Jesus' appearance renewed the hopes of two men. both Mark and Luke catches this. It's called the two on the road of Emmaus. After the resurrection, there were two who were walking from Jerusalem on the road towards the village of Emmaus. Luke said the two were moping around. Their heads were hanging low. Why? Because they thought their hopes had been buried with Jesus. While on their way to Emmaus, the two were in conversation about the arrest, the trial, the crucifixion, the burial of Jesus, when somewhere along the way, Jesus in incognito showed up to join them. Playing ignorant, Jesus asked them, "What's wrong with y'all? Why are you walking around with your head hanging low? Who you talking about was arrested, tried, crucified, and buried?" And the two were surprised that this stranger, who all of a sudden showed up, started walking with them, hadn't heard about the headline news. One or two asked if he was the only stranger in Jerusalem who did not know about the events of the past days. The two said, "We had hoped this Jesus was the one who will redeem Israel." The two had lost their hope. Their hope had been disappointed. Their hope and their dreams had ended in the grave. They were walking the road to Emmaus, walking in despair. Their hopes had been dashed. Their hope was in the grave with Jesus. Dr. Gregory Ellett, in his book, Cut Dead But Still Alive, he wrote that despair or hopelessness is broadly defined as the belief that the future is blocked and one suffering without meaning. Despairing individuals often feel disgusted or depressed and have a mindset that everything around them is negative. That in despair, they come to believe that what they want will not happen. That is no longer realizable. The two were dragging themselves back home filled with hopelessness. Despair, feeling disgusted and depressed. They were singing the blues, if you will, thinking that everything around them was negative and dull. Their future was blocked and hopes no longer realizable. When Jesus finally appeared, Jesus broke out of his incognito stage and he said to them, "Here I am, I'm alive." His appearance revitalized their hope, so much so that the record said it put running in their feet. And they went all the way back to Jerusalem to say, "Jesus is alive." What I come to tell you is when Jesus appears, he revitalizes your hope. He gives you hope all over again. He breaks you out of your despair. He lets you know there is a future for you. He lets you know that it is not over until it's over. There is a brighter day coming. Jesus renews and restores hopeful outlook on life. Lastly, in Mark's account of Jesus' appearances, he includes the 11 disciples, minus one, namely Judas. Luke records the same in Luke chapter 24. And together they say Jesus' appearance refired their ministry. While they were reclining at table, eating, the 11 didn't believe what Mary said. And they didn't believe what the two who were on their way to Emmaus returned and said. They all said, "Jesus is alive." But the record said the disciples persisted in their fears. They continued in their anxieties, their doubts, and their unbelief. You know, sometimes it's hard to believe someone else's experience. You need to have an experience for yourself. Well, the only thing that would calm their fears and ease their doubts was a personal, actual experience of the appearance of Jesus. Jesus broke through the room. The record said he didn't go through a door. He didn't knock on the door to say, "Let me in." He showed up because when Jesus shows up, he shows up on his own terms, in his own way. at his own time. His appearance calmed their fears, and it calms their doubts. But he not only calmed their fears and calmed their doubts, but his appearance was a catalyst for their commission. When Jesus appeared to the disciples, he soon after, he said, now calm down. I'm here now. I'm alive. But I didn't just show up just to show up. I showed up for you for a reason. Go into the world. Preach the gospel to everybody. Andrew Purvey said the resurrection of Jesus meant both faith and a job to do. Jesus said, when I showed up, I didn't just show up there to show up. I showed up to give you a job to do. After Jesus appeared to the disciples, they were no longer afraid. They were no longer ashamed, but was proud of to proclaim the gospel to anybody, everybody, anywhere, everywhere about their risen Savior. Because Jesus' appearances will embolden you. Jesus' appearances will empower you. Jesus' appearances will inspire you. Jesus' appearances will ignite you. Jesus' appearance will fire you up. When he shows up, he will fire you up. When Jesus shows up, he will fire you up like President Obama did. Y'all remember a woman by the name of Edith Childs? Edith Childs from Greenwood, South Carolina. While she was attending a small campaign event in her hometown in Greenwood, South Carolina, it was Edith Childs who saw for the first time the then Senator Barack Obama. She was in that crowd. And when Obama appeared, it set her on fire. So much so, Edith Childs was the one who came up with the chant, fired up, ready to go. Fired up, ready to go. Fired up. Fired up. If Obama did that for Edith Child, what ought Jesus ought to do for you when he shows up in your life? You ought to be fired up, ready to go. Fired up, ready to go. Fired up. When Jesus presents himself and he appears, he will fire you up and you'll be ready to go. Listen, y'all. If you ever lose your fire, if you ever lose your enthusiasm, if you ever you lose your excitement and energy, and you need to be fired up, if you ever need your ministry refired up, somebody ought to get on their knees and say, Lord, I need you to show up so I get fired up and ready to go. Let me bring this thing to a close. We got communion that was 14 that Mark and Luke recorded of Jesus' appearances. But according to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 6, Paul said, Jesus presented himself and appeared alive to more than 500 of his followers all at the same time, spent time with James and the rest of those he commissioned to represent him. When we take what Paul says as a proof of Jesus' resurrection, that Jesus lives, there were over 500 of what I call encountered persons. Has the Lord ever presented himself to you? Has the Lord ever appeared to you? Are you one of the persons that I call an encountered person? An encountered person. Andrew Purvey said, ineffably in prayer. in thought alone or with others, at work, at play, at our desk, on a hillside, or walking along a seashore, as well as sitting in a pew or in our private prayer corner, sometimes, especially when the season is dark, dangerous, wearisome, scary, lonely, despairing, at best limpid, uninspiring, and routine. He has met us. He has come in the spirit in his own freedom, and all we can say is, thus it is so. There's no access to what we know other than that it's having happened, that the Lord has come and has come to me. I am an encountered person. I wonder, do I have any encountered people in my midst? Have you had any personal presentations? Have you had any Jesus appearances in your life? Have you had any authentic encounters with Jesus? Perhaps it was during a prayer time that Jesus showed up. Perhaps it was in a worship time that Jesus showed up. Perhaps you were chilling on a beach with some Kool-Aid that Jesus showed up. Perhaps you were riding in your car on your way to work and Jesus showed up. Perhaps you were listening to one of those gospel songs and Jesus showed up. Perhaps somewhere you were walking around just thinking of God's goodness and he showed up. Or it doesn't have to always be in good times. Perhaps in the midnight hours while everybody else in the house was asleep, you were in another room with Jesus because he showed up. Or you in the valley experience of grief and the Lord came to your side and he showed up. Perhaps you were lying like me one day on a sick bed in the hospital and everybody was gone. No more visitors in the room and Jesus showed up. When you needed a friend to be near you and come to your rescue, he showed up. When you needed help to get you through and to get you over, he showed up. The Lord presented himself to you. Don't worry about if folks believe it or not. You know the Lord has met you somewhere. And the Lord has come to you somewhere. And I've come by to let you know you ain't crazy. You're not weird. You're not a fanatic. Because the Lord will show up sometime. And you are having an experience of Jesus' appearance. Have you had an encounter with the Lord? Has the Lord ever showed up in your life? He showed up one day to Bill Gaither. Bill Gaither had written 54 songs before he finally wrote what he called this breakout song. This breakout hymn that became popular in churches and made an impact on a national level. The story goes that the idea for the song came from an old preacher friend of Bill Gaither, whose name was Dr. Dale Oldham. Dr. Dale Oldham one day mentioned to his friend Bill Gaither, "You know, Bill, the word touch is a powerful word. Bill, do you know that that word touch comes up so often in the New Testament stories about Jesus touching people? Jesus touching people's eyes. Jesus touching people's infirm bodies. Jesus touching the casket of dead people. That word touch is a special word. And Bill, you ought to think about some of your encounters with Jesus. You ought to write a song that praises Jesus' touch." Bill thought about some of his experiences and the many times that he encountered Jesus' touch. Because you do know Jesus is alive. Something moved on the inside of his creativity got all in his mind. And he began to write these words. Shall go by your head. Continue to touch us, touch the sick. touch those who are walking in despair. Touch those who are worried of what they're going to eat, what they're going to wear, how they're going to make the bills. Touch somebody right now, oh God. Let them know that you are real, you are alive, you still exist, you still ain't. Touch somebody right now, call them to you right now. Show up to them right now and let them know you're real enough to be trusted. You're real enough to be served, to be loved, to be worshipped, to be obeyed. Touch somebody right now who's looking for a church home, who's been feeling out there that as though they've been out there all by themselves. Touch them, oh God, and let them know you want them back in the fold. You want them back home. Trying to tell you how to move. But Lord, we desire for you to move in our lives. Touch us, Lord. We need a touch. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. If you are in our virtual audience and would like to give your life to Christ or to become a member of the Antioch Missionary Baptist Church family, go to Antioch's website, antiochfamily.org. There you will find a discipleship form. Fill it out and send it back to us. Or you may send us an email by clicking the send email button on Antioch's Facebook page. And if you're here with us in person, you can get a discipleship form by just raising your hand and someone will come to you right now. Either way, if you want to give your life to Christ or you want to give your life to service to the church, we invite you to just raise your hand and an usher will come to you. On this 1st of May, which happens to be the first Sunday, as already noted earlier, for those of you who are joining us from home, we hope that you have already gotten yourself together with the necessary elements, be it a cracker or bread or juice or water or whatever it is. It's symbolic today for what we represent about our Jesus. So we ask that you prepare yourself. Those of you who are here, go ahead and start making yourself ready. You are separated the bread from the cup so that when it comes time for us to partake, we'll be ready. Gracious God, we do thank you for this day again. We gather. We gather to remember all that you have done for us. After your suffering, and because of your suffering, Lord, we are now saved. We've been touched. You touched us and made us whole. Bless this week we're about to receive in remembrance of all that you've done for us and what you mean to us. We forever give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus gathered the disciples together. He broke bread. Broke the bread, he said, this is going to symbolize my body. He passed the cup. When he passed the cup, he said, when you drink of it, it's going to remind you that I did this all for remission of your sins. So likewise, we prepare today. We take the bread. Bread symbolizes the body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He diminished Christ, but he knew that the end of it all would be our salvation. Take and eat, we all of it. Symbolizes the blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He shed his blood, and through his blood we have remission of our sins. Take ye, drink ye all. As often as we eat and drink of this cup, we proclaim to you a sermon. We continue the witness of what Jesus began to teach and to do. We are the ones that are the part two. He's depending on us. He has no plan B. He has us to be his witnesses. Again, next Sunday, we're looking forward. Next Sunday will be Mother's Day, but we're also going to celebrate Women's Day. I thought that would be a good way to acknowledge both. And so on next Sunday, we'll have a guest preacher, Dr. Monica Redmond from the St. Paul Baptist Church. assistant to the pastor there be our preacher. We're looking forward to the experience. Those of you who are able and in vicinity, if you would like to join some praying women, they're going to gather next Sunday morning at 9:30 in our fellowship hall. They're going to do an in-person gathering, just a short gathering before worship. And then we're going to come and celebrate with the women on Mother's Day, celebrate all women on that day. I think they have something special to give to you, present to you, and so that you will feel very, very special on that day. Let's stand upon our feet, prepare to be dismissed. Again, please be reminded of the fact that we need some helpers on Saturday before Mother's Day to help us get the word out of a great event that we're planning for the 14th of this month. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that through your word, you touched us. Through the preaching of the word, through the singing of the songs, through the praying of the prayers, through this fellowship, you touched us. You are alive enough to touch us, and we thank you. Now to him who's able to keep us from falling, able to send us to fall for the master's sin and great joy. To all wise God be glory, power, dominion, now his forever. We all say amen. Amen. Again, those of you who are with us, please wait till the usher to come to your row to dismiss you one by one from your row. They're working their way from the rear of the church to the front of the church. Have a blessed day. God bless you.